so much for the opportunity to present here today. Today we want to talk about how we have used an immersive VR environment in order to facilitate our own research into ancient spaces, and not only to answer the research questions that led to the creation of this environment, but also, as we found, to use it as a way to generate new questions and new ways to understand the spaces that we're studying. We're going to first introduce the case study for which the research environment was created, and then we're going to talk a little bit about the steps that we've taken to create the research environment itself. It's very much a work in progress, so we've structured it a bit more as a way to share our observations working with the environment so far in the creation of the environment. But before I begin, I would be remiss if I didn't show a slide of our team, because Una and I are just two members of a larger research collaboration between the Department of Audio Communication at the Technische Universität and the Departments of Classical Archaeology and of Cultural History and Theory in the Humboldt Universität. And one thing that you're probably missing here is we do not have anybody in our team who is specialized in game design or computer graphics and animation or computer science, so this is very much a do-it-yourself effort, and I think we've still managed to come pretty far, but we'll see what you think. Exactly. So we now turn to our case study, the Pnyx in Athens. It's a hillside in Athens located here, and you can see a bit of the other landmarks in Athens. In the ancient city, here's the Acropolis, here's the Agora, and the Pnyx is a hillside that leads up from the Agora. And the Pnyx was the location set aside in the city for the public assembly. And the public assembly was the most important decision-making body in Athenian democracy. This is where the laws were debated and voted on. Each citizen could address the assembly in order to persuade the people to a specific course of action. So addressing the assembly is one of the central acts of political communication in Athenian democracy. And the Pnyx is the space where this happened, where the speeches were given, where they were heard, where they were debated. So the question that we have now is how the space itself, which was so central to the working of democracy in classical Athens, how did it facilitate the political communication of the time, namely the giving and listening to of speeches? And a question like this requires a more multisensory approach, which would explain why we're trying to approach it using VR and simulations. So this is the site of the meeting place today, just so you have an idea of what we're looking at. The original public assembly probably made use of the natural slope of the hill. So the assembly gathered here, and the speaker was at the bottom of the hill, and the assembly faced then north towards the Agora, with the speaker standing beneath them. And at the turn of the 5th century, the Athenians expended an enormous amount of effort to switch the direction of the hill. They built a retaining wall and filled it with an earth fill so they could create a new platform, so that now the speaker, instead of standing at the bottom of the hill, he now stood at the top of the hill with the hill behind him, and the assembly gathered on this artificial platform. And what we see here, this retaining wall is actually from a later phase where they enlarged the space, and we're going to be focusing today only on to show our research environment. We're only going to be focusing on this second phase, the initial switching of the direction of the hill. Right, so the first step, if we want to simulate different sensory conditions, is of course the evidence-based digital reconstruction of the space. And this already we can use for beginning simulations of visual communications during a meeting of the public assembly. So we can render people the model and then render point of view images in order to determine how well the space facilitated visual communication. At what point can the speaker be seen from various points in the audience? We can also use our model for further simulations. For example, if we want to simulate the acoustic properties of the space, which is something else that we've done. For this purpose, we use the methods of virtual acoustics to create auralizations, that is, acoustic reconstructions for different points within the digital model of the Pnyx. And I'm not going to go into the details about how auralizations work, because that's not my field of expertise, but suffice it to say, it's possible then to choose different points on the Pnyx and then listen over headphones to a speech, in our case, a speech by Demosthenes. Here we have a picture of our Demosthenes being recorded. And yeah, in German. He speaks German for us. And you can go to the Pnyx then, or you can choose different points on the Pnyx and then listen on the headphones to what the speech would have sounded like from the different points that we've auralized. And each of these different simulations is separately already very useful because we can already begin to understand two different sides of political communication, the visual aspect and the acoustic aspect. How well could we see the speaker and how well was it possible to hear him? But with virtual reality and the immersive environment, we can go one step further and combine the visual and the acoustic simulations for a more multisensory approach, which is that the next step that we tried, and Una is going to talk a little bit about how we did that.
Yes, I already got the impression that you have already an idea of game engines, but anyway, I have a short introduction. So game engines like the Unreal Engine or Unity 3D are software development environments which are extensively used in computer games industry. And they are enabling the creation of a seemingly endless variety of scenarios. And one integral part of game engines is the so-called physics engine, which, in very short, is responsible for the complex simulation of phenomena resembling the physical world, like if gravity, you have friction, collision of objects, and wind, for example. And another main part of functionality is the real-time rendering engine, which, again, in very short, is concerned with the simulation of all things visible, from materials and textures to the proper conditions of light and shadow and animations. So game engines allow the constructor of such a scene to freely choose the desired perspective. So you can choose first person, third person, or any kind of point of view. And also do they come along with an inbuilt framework which simplifies the integration of VR technology. So regarding this broad spectrum of functionalities and tools, it becomes significantly easier to simulate and study multisensory experience as a method for scientific research. So now we have a short video prepared. We have to load it. So here you can see the scenario we've set up so far. The user, actually, when he's in the scene, the user starts his or her VR experience directly on the Pnyx in phase two during the public assembly, so which has already begun. The people have gathered, and the witness is already speaking and gesturing from the speaker's platform.
It's working. Huh?
It's a huge video, but maybe we have just the picture for now. Yeah.
An excellent advertisement for our demonstration later, so the video doesn't really do justice to the scene anyway. It's a completely different way to what you can see worse in the video than you can see if you're in the environment itself, so.
Lass es vielleicht einfach einmal laden.
Okay.
Oder dann das Bild einfach davon.
Ja, meins hier.
Ja, maybe. Wo ist denn der? Ja, no, it's really short. Small picture. Genau, also, so, as you could have been seen, the assembly was already, did already start, and the people are gathered here, and we have Demosthenes, badly seen here, but much more better seen in the real experience. And you can also see ear symbols floating above the crowd, which are indicating our specific listening points for the where we made the auralization. And when you're entering such a point under the ear and on the floor for your orientation, there's a yellow circle. When entering such a point, the acoustic impression of the speech at this specific location will be accurately live auralized according to your varying head positions. So Demosthenes is always standing on the platform, and yeah. So maybe now, in the game engine, users can freely move between these six positions and can listen to the speech in order to study the sensory conditions of political communication. So asking themselves, how good? What can I hear? What can I see? And do I hear or actually understand things differently when changing my point of view slightly?
Okay. So at this point, everybody is probably thinking, but wait, what about the size of the crowd? What if the crowd is constantly interrupting the speaker? There's a large array of variables that would influence how well the audience could comprehend the speech. And it goes even further than that, than the scenario. It's also a question of the reconstruction itself. So, for example, for the Pnyx in this phase, there's no certain evidence for the location of the speaker's platform. And of course, where we locate the speaker's platform would influence the visual and acoustic communication with the audience. And the benefit of working with the game engine is that now it's easier for us to integrate these different variables into the scenario so that the researcher using the scene can now interact with it and adjust the variables as required by the research question. So we are no longer forced to present a single best option for a reconstruction, but we can make the reconstruction itself dynamic, which also is a way to underline that the evidence itself is not clear-cut. And how we've managed, or how it looks right now, this option in our research environment is something we're just going to show again. I'm going to try it the next video. We'll see if it works.
Yeah, but so in our VR research environment, this was done by a customizable interface, which we integrated into the virtual world, with which the user can individually manipulate various parameters while directly experiencing the scene. So it allows the researcher or the user as well to directly and immediately modify the already given setup of the scene by choosing between a range of options to either influence the reconstruction itself, for example, by toggle between the assumed locations of the speaker's platform, or to change or manipulate the acoustic properties of the scene, for example, the mood of the crowd. So you can switch between a calm, bored, or excited, or loud crowd, and you can make the listener speak in a calm and relaxed voice or in a very tense and excited kind of way. And you can manipulate the visual appearance of the scene. For example, you can change environmental influences like weather conditions, you can make it rain, or change the time of day, or the visibility of textures. You can switch off all the textures if you like, because they're disrupting. And all this in result, all these resulting differences can be compared in real time. So the research questions can be adjusted accordingly, and you really see what you're changing in real time in the scene.
Yeah. And of course the video again didn't work, so again, please stay afterward during the lunch break and use our demonstration.
Yeah, right. And also, yeah. We are facing similar problems as you mentioned before. The interface design in VR is very difficult, especially if you have no background in this area. And as you can see, our current interface is one unchanging point or spot within the environment, partly because it was originally designed for 2D use, for desktop use, and not for VR. So one of our future aims is to achieve a more dynamic and user-friendly interface or a way of interacting. And for that, we are going to adapt the overall design of the interface to fit the special requirements of VR for experiencing interaction in VR. And that means, or that is, instead of being a static and fixed and 2D interface, we will be attaching the interface directly to the user and his or her actions to have a more tangible and three-dimensional part of the user experience. Of course, we faced some pitfalls and problems on the road of our project. So the two main technical limitations we are facing is the auralization. So we choose the six spots for the auralization, but it would be very impressive to just walk freely around the Pnyx and have in every spot have the live auralization. But this is absolutely over the top and kind of Assassin's Creed benchmarking, because it needs so much computational and calculation power of the other computer. And as you can see, we need two setups. The right computer is for the oral simulation and the left one for the visual simulation. And yeah, that's one huge point. And the other point, technical limitation, is that we try to have 6,000 people in the assembly on the Pnyx, and the game engine, we repurposed the game engine somehow. And game engines are widely used for mobile gaming, and you have mobile applications, and 6000 is absolutely out of every range that is possible for computers to fluently have the scene working.
Right. But we don't want to end our talk with this note about everything that we can't do. So I just want to summarize quickly the benefits that we've observed of using the VR and the game engine as our research environment. That with the game engine and in the immersive environment that we've created, that now we have the ability for a more multisensory interaction with the archaeological evidence, which impacts also the kind of questions that we now all of a sudden are aware of that we hadn't been aware of before, because of this ability to interact with the evidence. We can also adjust the variables in real time so that we can compare which influence they have on sensory perception, so that maybe sometimes you can say if one element that always pops up in talks is maybe not so not as relevant as people think, because if you compare it in the environment, you'll see that however many people are there, you can still see at the same points, for example. It's not a result, I don't quote me on that, but that's something that you could do now with the research environment. And another thing that we can do by allowing the research, the variables to be adjusted, is that we thereby make also the uncertain elements part of the research experience itself. So that instead of we just describe which parts of the reconstruction or which parts of the scenario itself are based on different kinds of evidence or not based on much evidence at all, now we can give them back to the user, so that they can adjust it themselves. And another important element is we've observed using the game engine or using the immersive environment that we've created that it always leads to new questions. And the good thing about using the game engine is that we can always integrate further elements into the research environment. So for example, what we don't have here, but what we would like to do is, of course, to be able to compare the three different phases of the Pnyx, so that we can understand the changes to the space and if the changes to the space had anything to do with the change in sensory perception, if that was important. And that's something that is, I wouldn't say easy, but more easier to do with the game engine. And most importantly, that using an environment like this, we can now share these results with other researchers and users. So we've been talking about the research environment. It's not just something, we designed it and we created it, but it's not just us that we're expecting to use it. We're expecting then that we can share our results and the results, the conclusions that we've met based on using the environment with other people, so that they can see for themselves if they can observe the same thing or not. And that already leads to a dialogue where we can see if maybe we have to change an element in the reconstruction or maybe reconsider some of our results. And this is something that we hope that you will also join us with using our demonstration then later, so you can see for yourself what we're talking about. Thank you.